I've always been fascinated by steam engines, and steam became very much a way of life. There was always this fascination with railways and trains and engineering. If my railway with a wave of a magic wand could become the Lynton and Barnstaple, and one could turn back the clock and just buy all the bits and pieces, which after all were sold very, very cheaply, and just somehow bring the Lynton and Barnstaple back to life.
Travelling in a steam train is like being pulled along by a horse. It's as if it's alive. It snorts. You can feel it pulling. The rattle of the wheels is like the clicking of the hooves, and your seat sways around underneath you. The sensation's strongest on the small-scale narrow-gauge railways, run mostly these days for holidaymakers, like this one in the Brecon Beacons. And the smaller and quainter they are, the more we enjoy the ride. Well, some of us do. 50 years ago, narrow-gauge railways were being sold for scrap. Now they're being searched out and put back to work, some by companies, some by railway societies.
Any tickets, please?
And a few by determined individuals. This tiny railway has been rebuilt from scratch at Launceston in Cornwall by Nigel Bowman and his wife, not Lillian, but Kay.
Narrow-gauge railways were fascinating to me because of the equipment that they used always looked a little bit quainter and a little bit odder than the main lines. And narrow gauge wound off into the country, it went up mountains, it went through valleys, it went round sharp corners and up steep gradients. And that blending of the countryside and railways is to me very attractive. I'd gone to North Wales and stumbled across Penryn Slate Quarries. Although it was closed, there were a few engines still for sale. And when I found that one of the engines was available for only £60, that was just too good to miss.
I rebuilt her between 1964 and 1968, and then she was doing nothing for years and years until we got the railway off the ground in 1983. Since then, she's done about 12,000 miles, and this winter we shall be giving her a big overhaul.
My career was school teaching, and with a railway engine which needs a lot of work doing on it to get it into good working order, then any career really pales into insignificance.
Nigel Bowman's railway is the result of 10 years' hard work. It's the realisation of his personal dream, inspired by one of the best-loved and most sadly missed narrow-gauge railways of the past, the Lynton and Barnstaple in North Devon, which closed in 1935.
I think the Lynton and Barnstaple Railway is very evocative in as much as it's remembered by old illustrations, sepia photographs, snips of cine film which people took just before it closed. And we all look back at those illustrations of it and the memories of it, and it's very clear that it was such a fine railway, but it does, in a way, it's an inspiration to people who are running narrow-gauge railways.
A wealthy Victorian publisher, Sir George Nunes, who'd built a large house at Lynton, was the impetus behind the line. It opened in 1898 to much local rejoicing. The little trains had to work hard on the difficult route between Lynton and Barnstaple, but justified Sir George's faith in narrow-gauge railways.
We'd look back now on the Lynton and Barnstaple as something very quaint, but in its day, it was a real leader. The locomotives that it used were quite the most modern that were available then. And everything about the line was extremely well done. The whole railway was very much a main line in miniature. I think the special thing about the Lynton is it was very much its own railway. It was built by local people for local people. It was built as a tourist project to carry people to Lynton, and it did that in a very charming and picturesque way through beautiful countryside. But at the same time, it was a real railway. It connected with the main line, and it had a real role to play.
The line closed in 1935, not because it didn't prove itself. It simply fell victim to the motor car. A wreath was laid on the stop block at Barnstaple Station. The inscription, "To Barnstaple and Lynton Railway, with regret and sorrow from a constant user and admirer. Perchance it is not dead, but sleepeth." It was a sad day, but what a brave face they put on it. You'd have thought it was their first day at work, rather than their last. That young man squatting by the wreath was Fred Kidwell, a fitter at the Pilton Depot in Barnstaple.
This was the carriage sheds back in the old days.
Yes.
And that was the good shed.
I see.
For the office.
Yeah. And that was 1925?
Yes, and before.
Yeah. And this was all carriage sheds then?
Yeah, right through.
51 years after that photograph, Fred Kidwell went back to his workplace for the first time since the line closed and the rails were ripped up. Talking with the present owner, that yard was suddenly all bustle again.
And the lines came round?
We used to have the goods road up through here.
No forklift trucks at the main depot in those days. They employed over 30 men here. It was really the freight that provided the line's bread and butter, right to the end, until road transport took the trade. What wouldn't enthusiasts give, though, to put that neat little railway train back on its tracks? It was at the Pilton depot that they were kept and serviced.
I was 16 when I started here in July 1925. Cleaning engines. That was my first job of cleaning. 28 shillings in the July when I started. I had a birthday in December, and I went up to 32 shillings. If you was working on a railway, you were sure of a job. And that was the main thing that you had to worry about, wasn't it, back in those days, was getting a job and keeping it. But out here, there was two pits where the engines used to come in to be serviced, to clean the fires, do the axle, the ash pan,
yeah,
and the smoke box door.
And the ash used to go in the pit there?
Go in the pit. And that's where the examination used to take place.
Yeah.
Then they used to run them into the shed.
Is that the marks there where the lines used to?
This is the actual gauge, which was my father's, because he was the ganger on this length of railway.
It's very narrow.
1 foot 11 and a half. This was the sheds where the engines were stored during the night. And you could see where the chutes were right down through, where the chimneys used to be right opposite.
To take all the
beams are still sooty, half a century since an engine stood there. There were five of them in all, named after West Country rivers. X, Lynn, Yeo, Tor and Lou. Their careers came to an end on the 29th of September, 1935. It was all such a shock when it happened.
I was in that engine shed that morning and the governor came in from Exmouth Junction. He said, "Good morning, lads. Well, I've come to close you up."
And that was it. Within a few weeks, the entire railway had been auctioned off, to scrap merchants mainly. It was like the breakup of a marriage with outsiders picking over the family treasures. The pain of it, to see lot numbers slapped on all that lovingly polished brass and paintwork.
Including 16¾ miles of track, signal and telegraph apparatus, 5 tank locomotives, 17 8-wheel passenger carriages, 19 open goods wagons, 10 covered goods wagons, 3 8-ton goods brake vans, plate layers trolleys, turntable, portable cranes, weighbridge, repair shop. Lot 13, a 242 outside cylinder side tank locomotive, Lynn, number 762 by Baldwin's Loco Works USA. Total weight, working order, 22 tons, spares, 8 tyres, 9 springs, 16 mouthpiece protectors and 4 brass bearings. Sold for £50.
Unlucky 13. In a few days, Lynn and 3 of her sisters were dismembered. Just over £50 apiece, that's all.
I think all of us who are involved in narrow gauge, if we could just turn the clock back and rescue some of the stuff from that auction. Certainly the rolling stock, when it was sold, wasn't run down. It wasn't dilapidated. It was in perfect condition. It was a railway in tip-top shape, ready to run. And what was it sold for? It was sold for summer houses, for chicken sheds, for garden shelters. And these superb carriages were just left out to moulder.
The signal box went. But one of the locomotives escaped the blowtorch. That was Lou, knocked down to work for a coffee plantation in Brazil. No more was heard of her, and some say she's still there. 3 carriages survived, One was burnt in the 1960s, another's on a preserved railway line altered out of all recognition. But this one spent 50 years in the garden of a rectory. If only that coach full of clerics had prayed a little harder and a little earlier. For his few pounds, the rector got a first-class observation saloon, a third-class compartment, a guards van and a dog box. But, praise be, it was saved and waits to be restored in the York Railway Museum. It would take thousands just to return the first-class saloon to its former glory. It's a classic example of Victorian coach building, before formica replaced mahogany and air conditioning took over the job of a leather strap to let the window down. Andrew Dow helped to organise its rescue in 1982. He made a sentimental journey to York with Stanhope Baker, who half a century before had spent a happy summer holiday riding the Lynton line.
You know, it was over 50 years you last travelled on the Lynton and Barnstaple, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. It was in the last months of its life, 1935. And I actually travelled in this coach once, I remember.
Yes. 1898 it was built.
Yes, yes.
In Lawrence Hill in Bristol.
Really?
In a Bristol carriage and... No, I must get the name right. The Bristol Wagon and Carriage Works Company Limited. In fact, there's a little plate up there.
It's still there, is it?
Yes, indeed it is. The common thinking is that these coaches were the best available on narrow gauge.
They must have been quite high class, I would think, yes. It's all scaled down mainline stuff, isn't it, really? The luggage racks and even the photographs above the seats there.
And when it's restored, expensively, I don't doubt, it really will be a lovely coach.
Yes. And the sideways seating allows the passengers to look out straight ahead of him, as it were, instead of as an angle. Well, sitting here, it brings it back to me. Amazingly.
Does it?
Oh, indeed, yes.
Yes. You can feel it sway beneath your feet, can you?
Yes, it did rattle a little bit when I was travelling in it on that short distance, because it was the last coach in the train, and
yes,
it wagged a little bit, but not bad, not very pleasant.
Yes.
And a beautiful view.
The view is still much the same, but could any part of this line ever be restored, really? Most of it's vanished into the landscape. Here at Chelfham, though, you can see that once there was a railway. Chelfham Viaduct had been the costliest structure on the line to build. It took over a quarter of a million bricks. It's already listed as an ancient monument, though British Rail would no doubt gladly sell it off to anyone prepared to keep it up. Today, there would be plenty of buyers for the whole line. Our misfortune was that the Lynton closed down too early. If only... Oh, well.
I think there's no doubt that if the line had somehow survived the war years until, say, the early 1950s, it would still be with us today.
The fact is, though, that ever since the wreath was laid on its grave, its ghost has haunted the enthusiasts. Could we ever see a locomotive rescued from the Brazilian jungle chuffing along any part of a revived Lynton to Barnstaple railway line? Could the spirit of Sir George Newnes wave his checkbook over the old station inn and transform it back into Blackmore Gate Station? Perchance it is not dead, but sleepeth. It isn't impossible to find the old wayside platforms where only rattling milk churns and an approaching train disturb the peace. They're still there, drowning under willow herb and bracken, but now Woody Bay Station is just a cottage in a wood. It almost came back to life in the early 70s when Nigel Bowman was searching for somewhere to start his railway.
The first place we looked, obviously, was the legendary Lynton and Barnstaple line. In places, you could have virtually cut down the trees and laid the track. It was intact. But any line which has been closed for a number of years, little bits have been sold off. And although there were short stretches which could have had a railway put on them, it would have been extremely difficult to buy back all pieces of land and to have persuaded the Highways Authority that they'd really got to undo their road improvements and put the railway back. We looked long and hard at the Lynton and Barnstaple, and eventually, and very sadly, decided that we couldn't do anything economically on the site, although we could quite see that it would be possible.
But not everybody took the same view. Lynton was Bill Pryor's favourite station and his favourite bit of railway history. He bought it and at once set about living his own legend. Mr and Mrs Essery were once regular passengers here. Bill Pryor loves to swap stories with people who knew the line.
Yeah. Train used to go through the middle of the night.
Come in.
Okay.
Yeah. There you are. This used to be the office of the station master.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Yeah, that's some of the old time tables.
And then the waiting
room. No. Oh, yes, Lynton and Limerick. Yeah.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
And up there?
Yeah.
There you are.
1911. Yeah. That's 4 miles down.
We'll catch that one next week.
That's it. Mm.
We'll get that one next week, shall we?
Yeah.
Do you remember the old bookstall in there?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, W.H. Smith's.
Yeah.
It's where you used to come and pick up the papers mornings, no.
We don't want them on here because they're too big. Yeah. We still prefer to have our little one.
That was the ticket office.
Yeah.
Which is now the bathroom of the house.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
That's the old Edward VII box.
Yeah. I didn't remember each of them.
I do. I remember that one. Yes, quite easy. Mm. Quite easy.
Yes.
It's beautiful to be up here, though, now again to see.
Of course, you wonder what habitat is here then. You know.
That's true.
It is lovely to see something being used up.
Yeah, the waiting room.
That's the waiting room.
With a little black stove in the middle.
General room, isn't it? Yeah. Lovely. Yeah. Isn't it really beautiful?
Yeah.
To see it all so nice again. Lovely.
It's good.
Touch it back to what it was.
When we go out the other side, well, then there was the Limerick and Lynton. Lynton and Limerick class, a big sign.
Yes,
that was on the other platform,
And down where the laurels be used to be the signal box.
That's it.
And up over was the water tank.
That's it, and the engine shed.
That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, the engine shed's under highways.
That's it.
They had two platforms here, one for the one passenger in general, and then one they used to shunt along the odd bits and pieces are waiting to be hooked up to the back of the general.
There used to be a seat you could sit on.
But it's all gone.
All gone, yeah.
Maybe. For now, anyway. Bill Pryor can't accept that it'll be forever.
Hopefully, maybe in the distant future, a section of the old line will be reopened as a tourist attraction. It would do extremely well. It'd bring a lot of wealth to the area and try to recreate the most famous narrow gauge railway.
This is how the track looked just north of Bratton Fleming in the 1930s. Two bends and one of the 80 bridges on the climb to Lynton. It has changed a bit. It may be a little overgrown, but it is a railway again. David Moore is someone else with a grand obsession about something he never really knew. He owns about half a mile of the track bed, and on it, he's busy building his own Lynton and Barnstaple railway. The gauge of his track is just 7 1/4 inches, about a third of the original. The engine, Bratton, he built himself. The track he also laid. His reward is to stoke up his imagination until he's at the controls of one of Lynton's tough little tank engines, pounding up the bank to Blackmore Gate. David spends most weekends like this. It's a satisfying feeling to be on the footplate of your own engine, even though it's a bit cramped. He has no plans to tap the tourist market. This is a purely private world. Playing trains? Certainly. But Bratton is no toy. At half a ton, it can pull 8 times its own weight. David Moore's next locomotive will be even more powerful, a scaled-down miniature of Tor, an original Lynton engine. For some, this would never be enough. The urge to rebuild the railway as it was is too strong. It must be the original 1 foot, 11 1/2 inch gauge carrying tourists again. At Lanky, near Barnstaple, hidden under scrapped symbols of what put them out of business in the first place, are some more enduring items of railway hardware. This is the base of the Lynton and Barnstaple Railway Association. It's run by Clarence de la Court.
The main aim of the society is to open so much of the old L&B railway as we possibly can. We'll never open all of it, obviously. But we're mainly concerned with a small section, possibly 2 to 3 miles. We've got a locomotive. We've got 10 railway wagons of our own. We've got sections of the old L&B carriages. A lot of equipment, a lot of rail, a lot of sleepers. We're very confident. We'll get a section reopened in the next 2 years. It will be the main tourist attraction for the Barnstaple area, definitely.
It may seem far-fetched, but it's already been done elsewhere.
If one was going to look around for a line to say this line is being done in the same way that the Lynton and Barnstaple was, one would certainly look at the Brecon Mountain Railway and put it probably at the top of the list, because it uses very substantial track, very heavy rails, very well laid, and the rolling stock in many ways is not dissimilar. And everything about the Brecon Railway has been done to achieve the best, the station facilities in particular. And I think one would draw a parallel there with the Lynton and Barnstaple Railway, which in its day was certainly at the forefront of railway technology.
The Brecon Mountain Line is one of the great little trains of Wales. Every year it delights 40,000 passengers. Yet only 10 years ago, it was a wilderness, just like the Lynton and Barnstaple. All it needed was vision, money and ability. Three things possessed by Tony Hills.
What's the cost compared to fish-plated joints? Any idea?
Well, they say it's £40 a joint, you see.
As much as that?
Tony Hills discovered the route of the old Brecon and Merthyr Railway. He discovered that at about the same time that I discovered a section of the North Cornwall Railway. And being a practical engineering sort of chap, it's no wonder that he started a railway in much the same way that we have in Cornwall.
Tony, she's enormous. She must be the biggest narrow gauge engine in this country.
Well, as far as I know, she's the biggest 2-foot gauge loco ever built. There were quite a few built of this type for the South African railways, but it weighs 61 ton with coal and water on.
And you've recently brought her back from South Africa?
That's right, yes. It's been here since March, and we hope to have her running before too long. But of course, we've got to strip all the lagging off. The boiler's got to be inspected. We've got to get a boiler certificate.
One of the problems about railways of about 2-foot gauge is shortage of equipment. 20 years ago, stuff was available in England, mostly with an industrial background. That source of supply quite suddenly dried up, and not surprisingly, people started looking overseas, and Tony Hills has taken the bull by the horns and imported a large South African Beyer Garrett locomotive, which is now on the Brecon Railway.
But when we started on this, Tony, stuff was comparatively cheap, wasn't it? I paid £60 for an engine for one of the Welsh slate quarries.
That's right, those were the days, weren't they?
That's right.
Yeah, the Sybil here, I bought that in 1963, and I think I paid £80 for it or something. I mean, it was a bit of a state then, mind you.
Good investment.
I suppose so.
But what are we talking about today for even a small working steam locomotive in fair condition for a narrow gauge railway?
Well, the thing is that you say in working condition. Well, I suppose in that case, you're talking of perhaps £10,000.
Exactly.
A wreck you might get for £5,000.
So the costs are high. But then for Nigel Bowman, the rewards are great.
So many of your senses are stirred by a steam engine. You can smell it, you can hear it, you can see it. And it's very much alive, even when it's not moving. There's something going on. It's warm, it makes a sort of crackling noise as water drops onto hot surfaces. There's a smell of warm oil. There's something very magical about it. It's an incredibly straightforward, simple machine. And because it's so straightforward and simple, it's also beautiful. It's made of straightforward materials, brass and cast iron and steel. and yet crudely fitted together. It was a very crude machine that can work so well and achieve so much.
To the new generation, born into a high-tech world, steam trains are a mystery.
They look at a steam engine for the first time, and it looks very large, and it's an awe-inspiring object. And they step back, and perhaps they're a little bit frightened, but then gradually they edge closer and closer, and within half an hour, they don't want to leave it. And I'm sure that they go away from these little tourist railways, and all they want to do is to come back or go to another one. And that's it, they're hooked. There's a lot of parallels with looking at the tourists getting onto the train at Pant Station on the Brecon Mountain Railway. You can just imagine that was really not so very different from tourists getting onto the train at Lynton Station, embarking on a journey. And as the train winds off round the corner, you get a glimpse of what promises to be a very attractive journey through beautiful countryside behind a steam engine. And that's really not so very different, I would have thought, from the emotions that a tourist would have experienced with a ride on the Lynton and Barnstaple Railway maybe 50, 60, 70 years ago. The differences are, of course, that the Brecon Railway, as with so many today, is a recreation of what the Lynton and Barnstaple was all about. It's a recreation, in a way it's a caricature, but it's an extremely accurate one. It's no mock-up using artificial equipment. It's no amusement park thing. Everything about it is real. The locomotives are real, the rolling stock is real, the track bed itself has got a history, and when it comes to it, even the rails have got a history. But it's been assembled together to make a recreation of something that was there before. I think the man behind the Lynton and Barnstaple Railway, Sir George Newnes, would, if he's looking down on the Brecon, feel a great rapport with it. I'm sure he'd be saying to himself, well, there we are, my ideas were absolutely right. A narrow gauge railway in beautiful countryside is what people want. There's something about the railway. It's an era which has vanished. We're looking back to the days when people went on holiday, not by car, but by train. And I think a lot of us, of course, still remember that. But even those who don't still capture a magic from the railways. And the number of people who are interested, the number of holidaymakers who ride on preserved railways is a testimony to the fact that Sir George Newnes was absolutely right.